Did you know? While Gordon Ramsay stands as one of the most famous and wealthiest chefs in the world today, his childhood could not have been any more different. In fact, Ramsay grew up in relative poverty. Although he was born in Johnstone, Scotland, Gordon's family constantly moved from town to town across Britain due to his father's inability to hold down a job. Worse yet, his father was violently abusive and often manipulated Ramsay throughout his formative years. He pushed Gordon to become a musician and would disparage other pursuits such as cooking using homophobic slurs. But Ramsay's first true love wasn't cookery, it was soccer, or football as it's called in UK and the rest of the world. Not only did football serve as an escape from his toxic household, but Ramsay was genuinely talented at the game too. He was eventually scouted by Glasgow's famous Rangers football club. However, just as he began to solidify his position on the team, a nasty training accident shattered the cartilage in his knee, taking him out of the game for 11 weeks. Afraid of being replaced, Ramsay ignored his doctor's advice to rest and jumped back into sports at the first chance he could. Soon enough, after only a single game of squash, he tore his cruciate ligament and was put in a plaster for another 4 months. Yet again, Ramsay trained zealously as soon as he was back on his feet, ignoring the constant pain and swelling. In spite of this, his coaches saw that his leg just wasn't the same and took him off the team. He was told to drop down a league and try training himself back up again, but Ramsay refused. He didn't want to become a hopeless dreamer like his father, a failed musician whose inability to give up ruined his family's lives. Gordon ultimately decided to let the sport he loved go and sought out a new career. As it turns out, Ramsay stumbled into cooking merely due to circumstances. He considered cooking nothing more than a chore in his youth, but after being unable to join the Navy nor the police, he decided to give catering college a shot thanks to a sponsorship. He fell in love with his classes almost immediately and dove into his studies. Ramsay was determined to never endure the failure he experienced in football again. He began working in a handful of eateries till he landed a position running the kitchen in the Wickham Arms in Oxfordshire. This experience gave Ramsay room to grow as he continued to study endlessly, and his dishes became popular enough to turn the business into a local hotspot. Although things began to get complicated as Ramsay became entangled in an affair with the owner's wife. As things escalated, he realized he was only able to cook whatever he wanted due to his illicit relationship. Worried that the cards could come tumbling down at any minute, Gordon decided to seek greener pastures in London. While Ramsay quickly found work in the capital, he was disappointed by how many of London's restaurants were rife with lazy or outright bad cooking that put more of an emphasis on convenience and quantity over actual quality. After he was written up for personally scrambling eggs one morning rather than throw them into a hot water bath that produced rubbery eggs, he knew he had to get out and find a place he could actually learn from. Inspired by British chef Marco Pierre White's success, Ramsay called him up for a job. At first, White wanted nothing to do with Ramsay, but after he admitted he planned to go to France to learn how to cook, White gave the young chef a shot. Ramsay showed up to White's restaurant the next day and was so impressive he was offered a job starting the following Monday. However, Ramsay was obligated to give his current job a month's notice before he left. White implied that Ramsay could work both jobs, saying, "Well, if you really want the job that f***ing badly, you start Monday." Ultimately, Ramsay continued to work from 7 a.m. to 4 p.m. at his old job, then book a train to White's where he worked till 2 a.m. the following morning for a whole month. Ramsay learned a great deal in White's kitchen, stating the experience forever changed how he cooked. Nevertheless, that didn't excuse the fact that White had a notorious temper, ruling the restaurant with an iron fist and sometimes quite literally beating his employees. Ramsay wrote in his memoir, "He would praise you and then he would knock you down. He would abuse you mentally and physically. His mood swings were unbelievable. One minute he was all smiles, ruffling your hair, practically pinching your cheek. The next he was throwing a pan across the kitchen." Ramsay walked out a few times, but White would coax him back again and again. Despite being advised by more experienced chefs to run away from White as fast as he could, Ramsay stayed. He believed that through all the abuse, White was sharpening him into a better chef every day. Gordon ultimately cooked at White's restaurant for almost 3 years till he decided he had both learned and had enough. From there, Ramsay made his way into French cuisine, first working at an authentic French restaurant in London to a ski resort in the French Alps, before going to Paris itself. This period of his career not only taught him how to make French food, but expanded his palate and opened his eyes to techniques he'd never experienced in Britain. His most influential job during his stay ended up being a stint with Guy Savoy's. Despite a cold reception from being an English cook in a French kitchen, Ramsay pushed himself to work twice as hard. He'd often come in and volunteer to work for free on his time off to earn respect and move up the ranks. His labor paid off, and he was eventually noticed by Guy Savoy himself and taken under his wing. In fact, with a few of Savoy's dishes, Ramsay was able to beat out more experienced and impressively titled chefs to become the UK's National Chef of the Year in 1992. He was even offered to become Savoy's right-hand man, but Ramsay turned down the offer, seeking to learn more elsewhere. Next, Ramsay worked with Joël Robuchon, and while his time at the famous chef's restaurant proved educational, Ramsay alleges that the abuse he endured there made his time with White look like a joke. Gordon suffered for 10 long months before he couldn't handle it anymore and called it quits. Utterly broken by his time at Robuchon's, Ramsay knew he needed some time to renew his spirit. However, Ramsay was relatively broke financially and still needed money to make ends meet. Luckily enough, he ended up serving on board the late Australian media mogul Reg Grundy's private yacht as the head chef. This job was just the ticket Ramsay needed to raise his spirits. The yacht had a much humbler and less stressful kitchen, and sailed the seas to places like Sardinia, Corsica, Gibraltar, and the Bahamas. Moreover, the pay topped anything he'd ever been dealt in his life yet. Still, as tempting as the sea life was, he didn't want to become too comfortable and lose sight of his dreams of opening his own restaurant. Thus, after saving up as much money as he could, he returned to England once again with a mission. Ramsay soon found a position as the head chef of one of London's rising restaurants, but as it turned out, he was working for one of Marco Pierre White's rivals. When White found out, he gave Ramsay a deal he couldn't pass up. Turn around a failing restaurant in exchange for 25% ownership of the business. Just like White's last deal, though, he demanded Ramsay start the following week no matter what. It didn't take long for the now 26-year-old chef to make up his mind, so he took out a loan of £10,000 and went to work immediately. This became the Aborigine, Ramsay's first crowning success, which went on to attain 2 Michelin stars in just 3 years. This success impressed White enough to offer Ramsay a lofty salary to become his personal top chef. Ramsay turned down the offer, though, wishing instead to become a 3-star chef himself. This infuriated White, who began to see the young man as an ungrateful rival. Meanwhile, Ramsay's business partners' ambitions began to grow too quickly for his own comfort as well. They wanted to expand the Aborigine into bistros, breweries, pizza joints, and so on across the globe, but Ramsay stood firm, refusing to lose focus on his closely controlled high standards rather than sell out. Nevertheless, it soon became clear that his partners were working behind his back to get what they wanted one way or another, likely by replacing him with White. Ramsay claims he received an anonymous phone call one day warning him, "Watch your back. Don't trust any of them. They're about to sell the company, and they're going to sell you with it." Terrified of losing everything he had worked for, Ramsay devised a devious scheme. One day, a man wearing a motorcycle helmet ran into the Aborigine, snatched the reservation book, and took off. In the days before everything was computerized, this could cripple businesses, especially ones such as the Aborigine, which was completely booked months in advance. Afterwards, Ramsay suggested to journalists that White may have had something to do with it, a suspicion that stuck with many, especially the Aborigine's business members. In reality, however, Ramsay orchestrated the whole thing in a plot to keep White from taking over the establishment by turning his partners against him, and it worked. Ramsay confessed to the New Yorker in an interview nearly a decade later, saying, "You always eat revenge when it's cold, don't you? Trust me, this was stone cold. Even now it sends a chill down my spine, because it would have been all over if I'd been caught. But that's the risk you take, isn't it?" While this gave Ramsay time, it ultimately didn't save the Aborigine. As his relationship with his business partners grew more embittered and the direction of the company continued to go awry, he secretly prepared to jump ship and start over at a new restaurant ran by himself. Just before he finalized the deal, however, his top chef at the Aborigine was unjustly fired, causing Ramsay to lead a walkout in protest. Gordon invited his co-workers to join him at his next place, and around 46 people left on the spot. This caused the Aborigine and its sister establishment, the Loranger, to close for weeks as the remaining owners scrambled to hire a new crew. Out of this dramatic turnabout came restaurant Gordon Ramsay, the chef's first establishment he truly owned. Of course, Ramsay wasn't out of the frying pan just yet, as one of his business partners was determined to sue him for all he was worth after poaching their staff. During this period, Ramsay agreed to be filmed for what would become his first real foray into television, Boiling Point. Upon seeing the footage, even Ramsay himself was shocked with how he acted, admitting the incredible stress may have gotten to him at the time. Nevertheless, audiences loved it, and his restaurant's phones were bombarded with reservation requests in the weeks after it aired. Ramsay persevered, and in 2001, his restaurant was finally awarded the coveted 3 Michelin stars. Rather than sit on this success, though, he used the momentum to open up more restaurants while working along his trusted hand-picked staff to maintain his strict standards at each location. With each new establishment, lofty praise and Michelin stars followed, cementing Ramsay's reputation in the culinary arts to this day. While Ramsay was already a star within his field, he wouldn't become a household name until a few years later. The TV company Optimum Television created a 6-part miniseries in 1999 called If You Can't Stand the Heat. This series followed Michelin-starred chef-turned-consultant Pat McDonald as he visited failing restaurants in hopes of turning their businesses around. The show flopped, but the producers felt the concept still had legs and decided to approach Ramsay to give it another shot. The show went through multiple names during production, including Ramsay's Restaurant Rescue and Cutting the Mustard. But according to Ramsay's autobiography, the show found its title while they were filming their first episode, writing, "I came out of the very first restaurant we visited. This is a f***ing nightmare," I said to Pat Llewellyn, the show's producer, no doubt with genuine terror in my eyes. "That's it," she said. "We'll call the show Kitchen Nightmares." The name stuck, and despite Optimum's concerns over their star's constant cursing, Ramsay's Kitchen Nightmares went on to become a smash hit. Once again, Ramsay followed this success with more shows including the American version of Kitchen Nightmares, then Hell's Kitchen, The F Word, and more, shooting the hot-headed chef into the stratosphere of international superstardom. Today, Ramsay operates over 30 restaurants across the globe, from London to Las Vegas, Hong Kong to Dubai, and more. On top of his success in the restaurant and television scenes, he also has a lucrative writing career penning dozens of books, many of them international bestsellers, and regularly contributes to the Times Saturday magazine. Ramsay came in on number 33 on Forbes' World's Highest Paid Celebrities list, edging out Beyoncé with a kingly $60 million per year. Did you also know that McDonald's used to purposely space their chairs apart so that people would talk less and eat faster? Or that McDonald's was once in a fast food arms race known as the Burger Wars? For more facts, check out the Did You Know Food video on McDonald's.